This is Weird Night.
Good evening. You're watching BBC Two.
Welcome to Weird Night. Coming up this evening at 8:40, the Fortean Review of the Year charts the most bizarre events of 1994. Everything you're about to see has yet to be explained.
Not a weather balloon.
This is no dog job. No, I was scared.
The unexplained does exist. At 9:05, ordinary people tell extraordinary tales. Strange days on Weird Night.
He was standing outside the front of the house, and I said, "Hello, Mr. Jenkins," as I passed him. He raised his hands to the brim of his hat, nodded, but didn't say anything. Strange. Anything. Anyway, carried on, got to my front door, got into my living room, and there's my mother. First thing she said to me was, "Guess who died last night?" "No, sorry," she said, "Mr. Jenkins."
At 9:15 in the last American freak show, impresario Ward Hall brings together the human oddities of America for one last farewell performance.
Ooh, hit a bone. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
This is Ward Hall, the king of the sideshows. He's been my partner for over 27 years, but I'm afraid this is the end of the road.
I want to tell you how wonderful the show was with you all in it. It is unfortunate that the sideshow tradition has to end, but enjoy the farewell dinner.
At 10:10, WSH, when myths become fact.
Urban legends are disgusting!
Turns out that it's not a puppy doll, but it's a Haitian rat.
We are the knowing collectors. We know these stories aren't true because we've heard them 100 times.
And I mean, this is not a politically correct universe.
One worker reportedly urinated in a coffee pot being used by many other wire rope employees.
You hunt them down and kill everybody in the car, and then you're initiated into the gang.
Putrid!
The term we use when legend becomes fact.
At 11 o'clock, the X-rated X-Files, an edition so disturbing, it could only be shown on Weird Night.
That's weird.
I hate fire. Hate it. Phoebe is fire. Sooner or later, a man's got to face his demons.
The X-Files. The truth is out there. At 11:50, weird thoughts. What is weird? What is normal? What lies beyond human sense? Reasonable people discuss the unreasonable. This is Weird Night.
You're watching BBC Two.
And now, to present our night of weirdness, the man who made Attack of the Killer Crabs, Roger Corman, king of the B-movie, godfather of weird.
Hello,
I'm Roger Corman. One of the things that frightens me the most is the fear of losing control. The fear that my mind will no longer be able to respond to the stimuli of the outside world. In the 1950s, we were under the illusion that science would be able to give us this control. We now know that the weird, the bizarre, the paranormal speak to the unconscious mind. The unspeakable does exist.
The world is more mysterious than we realize if we keep an open mind. Such was the philosophy of writer and recluse Charles Fort, who spent his life recording unexplained phenomena. He died 60 years ago, but if he were alive today, he'd find a world which is becoming increasingly weird. Welcome to a Fortean year. January brought inexplicable pestilence.
Her family and friends gathered at the gravesite to bury Gloria Ramirez, 2 months after she died. And they have no better idea why she died than the day it happened. She was brought by ambulance one night to Riverside General Hospital with difficulty breathing. While drawing blood, her attendant smelled an odor and saw crystals in the blood. Within moments, 6 doctors and nurses became ill. The emergency room was evacuated and the hazardous materials squad called in. One of the affected doctors was Julie Gorchinsky, who spent weeks in the hospital. After she was released, she developed pain in her knees. Her doctors learned that her bones were dying. Her family and friends say Gloria Ramirez has been portrayed as something out of science fiction. But an autopsy conducted by a team of doctors in hazardous materials suits produced no quick answers. Neither did a private autopsy by the family.
It could have been the body. It could have been a source coming out of the drain.
And it could be something they may never find.
Neither could medical science explain the case of racehorse trainer Vic Rail, in perfect health until struck down by a mystery virus.
It's been revealed that Brisbane racehorse trainer Vic Rail died of the same mystery disease that killed 14 horses. A post-mortem has discounted earlier suggestions that Mr. Rail died of Legionnaire's disease.
The same virus which killed the horses also killed Mr. Rail.
In Britain, medics stood helpless in horror as a flesh-eating bug stalked the land.
As more gruesome details of the killer bug emerged, it would be easy to think we're on the point of an epidemic. But just how worried should we be? Terry Bowden died less than 36 hours after the first signs of illness. He'd had no contact with any of the other cases, no recent injuries, and he was only 39. It seems it can happen to anyone.
More confusion for doctors when hundreds of schoolgirls simultaneously fainted in Cairo. The epidemic quickly spread throughout the Nile Delta.
We received about 55 cases of female students in preliminary schools. We examined them. There is no any abnormal findings in their vital signs.
Yet there were also bizarre cures to match the rash of outlandish epidemics. A British soldier was exploring mountains in Borneo. He fell and gashed his hand. Gangrene infected the wound and he sought help in a remote village.
I turned the hand around to show one of the girls that was treating us and she sort of went ash and white and ran off.
The girl produced a jar containing rare herbs and snake flesh.
I took the lid off the jar and actually stuck my hand in the jar.
And the hand was made whole, the fingers saved, and medical science mystified. February was a month of weird attractions. Italian